Well, welcome to Faith at Sellersville. We are going to be starting a brand new series today that'll take us through our Christmas season, and we're going to get into that. But before that, let me just bring you up to speed on a couple of things. I was out last week, and I feel like I haven't talked to you guys in a little bit. So let me just bring you up to speed on a couple of things. First of all, with our Wednesday night program, of course, we're done with iBlast for this first session, and that was awesome, and that went really well. We were able to see a lot of kids come out to that. We were able to see a large number of people come out to our three Wednesday night classes that we held during the iBlast kids program. And so we're going to be picking that back up in February. In the meantime, you'll notice in your bulletin there's a Wednesday night class there that says I'm offering on leadership. And while that's true, the information in there isn't correct, okay? Because you'll notice if you're looking at those dates that a lot of them have passed already and you're missing out on it, we haven't started that class yet. In fact, One of the desires that I have, and one of the reasons that I want to do this, is God's just given me a deep desire and a passion for developing leaders and men particularly that will rise up and take leadership. A lot of you men find yourselves in positions of leadership already. Obviously, if you're a husband, a father, you're in a natural position of leadership that God has placed you there. Some of you in your jobs, you lead other people, men and women. And maybe you're in a volunteer position of leadership in the church, a deacon or whatever. God has called men to leadership. And I believe with all of my heart, when men take seriously the call of God upon their lives to be the leaders that God has called them to, then families are stronger, businesses are stronger, churches are stronger, communities are stronger. But what we've seen and what we see is a failure amongst men to take the leadership role that God's given them. Or simply they want to be leaders, or you want to be the leader that God's called you to be, but maybe you just don't know how. Maybe you haven't had that cultivated in you. Maybe you haven't had that taught to you. And so one of the things that I'm really passionate about, particularly with the men here at Faith, is that we would be men that become the leaders that God's called us to be. And so what I want to do starting December 7th, okay, that's a week from this coming Wednesday, so a couple weeks from now, December 7th, and I think we're going to meet over at the Gathering Point facility. The teens will be in there. Area, but there's a room over there I want to meet in. There's a conference table in the old kitchen there that I want to sit with any men that are interested in becoming a better leader. And one of the things that we're going to do is we're going to go through a book. And so I'm not calling it a book club because men don't do book clubs, okay? All right. But we're gonna read a book and we're gonna discuss it. John Maxwell wrote a book quite a few years ago, and I've been working through it myself, called The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership. That's the book we're gonna go through. And so if you have some time to either download that book or purchase that book, it's John Maxwell, The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership. And we're just gonna sit down, we're just gonna talk about leadership. It's written from a biblical perspective. So the principles from the book are biblical principles, but what it'll do is it'll help you men, whatever role of leadership you find yourself in, to be a better leader. So we'll have stronger families. We'll have a stronger church. And so whether you're old, young, any men that are interested, what if you're like, oh, I'm a woman, I want to be a leader. Okay, this one's not for you, okay? All right, we will provide opportunities for you women to grow, but this is for men. I want to help us as men discuss how God can help us to be the leaders that God's calling us to be. So that starts December 7th. We'll go for 2 weeks in December, and then we'll pick it back up in January until our next winter session of iBlast and our adult classes starts, okay? So that's coming up. I'm excited about that. If you have any questions, just see me afterwards. I can tell you all about it. If you forgot the book that we're going to be going through, I can let you know what book that is, and we'll send some email information out with that as well. Then as we head into this series, the I Am series, there is going to be an opportunity for everybody to reach out to somebody who doesn't know Christ this Christmas season. One of the things that we find in culture is that Christmas is a time when people who don't normally go to church, the unchurched, people that don't associate with the church, the nuns as they call them, so when you mark your information, what religious affiliation are you? You know, Catholic, evangelical, whatever, Mormon. They write none, okay? So a greater portion of our culture are the people that have none marked. No religious affiliation at all. No church affiliation. Don't go to church. Okay? That segment of our culture is growing more and more each year, which means we have a huge task before us as a church, right? The reason we're here is to do what? Not make a lot of money and live a comfortable, happy life. You know, tear down our barns and build bigger barns, eat, drink, and be merry for tomorrow we die. That is not what God's called us to. God has called us to His mission. And His mission, as we saw last year in the book of Acts, which we'll be picking up Acts again beginning in February of this coming year, is what? Go make disciples. And Jesus says, all power has been given unto you in heaven and earth. Therefore, you will be my, Acts 1:8, witnesses. And you'll take the gospel to Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Well, guess what? Sellersville, Perkasie, Quakertown, Souderton, Lansdale, Harleysville. Guess what that is? That's the ends of the earth. Okay? So it was written, you know, at the other end of the earth. We're here 2,000 years later on the other end of the earth doing that. And one of the things that we'll find is around Christmas time is people that are unchurched are so open to coming to church because there's just something about Christmas time and that just people are open to saying, yeah, let me go to church. Let me try church out. Let me just do something because after all, it's Christmas and people will acknowledge God and the baby Jesus in the manger. And so people will come to church around Christmas time. We just found that to be true in our culture. So we want to give you guys the opportunity as we preach Christ this Christmas season. We're taking 4 weeks, and we're going to unpack the words of Jesus when He said, I am the bread of life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am, and on Christmas Eve, Christmas morning, the resurrection and the life. When we unpack all of these, we're going to unpack who Jesus was. And so what we want to do is we want to invite people to experience and hear who Jesus was. So there's individuals that are in your lives that don't know Christ, and you know them. We all know people in our lives that if they died without Christ, we know that they would go into a Christless eternity. The question is what are we going to do about it? The question is, how are we going to take the message? How are we going to be witnesses to the ends of the earth, to our part of the world right here in northeastern or southeastern Pennsylvania? How are we going to do this here in the suburbs of Philadelphia? One of the ways is we're going to invite people out to hear who Jesus was this Christmas season. One of the things that we're going to do this year that's going to be a little different than previous years, and it's partially because Christmas falls on a Sunday. So if you're sitting here saying, oh, what are we going to do for, you know, Christmas? It falls on a Sunday. We're going to offer a Christmas Eve service and a Christmas morning service. They're going to be the same service. And what we're going to do is we're going to invite as many of our lost, unsaved people out to that service as possible. It's not going to be a long service. It's only going to be about an hour. We're going to have some music and some special music, and then I'm going to preach Jesus' words, I am the resurrection and the life. And what does that mean? And what does that mean for you? And what does that mean for those who are lost? So we're going to take two opportunities. And the reason we're doing this is because some people are like, yeah, I can make Christmas Eve. I'm there. You know, I'm open Christmas Eve. But I have stuff going on Christmas morning. Others are like, no, I can come Christmas morning, but Christmas Eve, I have family stuff. So realizing that people have different obligations with their families, we're offering two services that are going to be the same music and the same message. I'm going to be preaching both of those messages. But what we're asking you to do is to attend one of those services, but that you don't come alone, that you would give an invitation, and we're going to print up some invitations to you to hand out to someone and say, hey, why don't you join me for our Christmas Eve or our Christmas morning service? And I think you'll be surprised at how many people say, yeah, why don't we do that? And so we'll have some carols, some Christmas singing, some special music, and then we'll have not a long sermon, but we'll have a sermon that'll just unpack how Christ is the resurrection and the life. And we're going to unpack Christ this Christmas season. Now, here's the thing. You don't have to wait till the Christmas Eve or the Christmas morning service. We've got, starting this week, every one of these services are going to unpack who Jesus was in His own words. So if you'll go with me to John chapter 6 this morning, let's begin. Let's begin going through our I Am series. As we talk about Jesus, one of the things that we want to make clear here at Faith is that we're all about Jesus. If you're to boil down, okay, what is it that faith at Sellersville is really all about? Are we about social justice? Well, we love social justice. About feeding the poor? No, we love feeding the poor. You about racial reconciliation? No, we love racial reconciliation. You about raising men up to be leaders? Obviously, that's something we love to do. So there's a lot of things that we want to talk about, a lot of things that we want to promote. But at the end of the day, what we are about is Jesus, who he was, and what he did for you and for me and for this world. You see, there's a lot of viewpoints out there about who Jesus, like who was he? So when we go back to this manger scene, all right, and we're going to see nativities and manger scenes and bumper stickers and all kinds of things that talk about Jesus. You know, we're going to pull out our Christmas mugs and, you know, have the verses about on them and that's all well and good. But who was like this baby that was born, that shepherds came and worshiped, that kings came and gave gifts to? Like who was this baby? Who was this child? The most significant man in all of human history. Whether you're a Christian or not, it's hard to debate that there's anyone that's had a bigger impact on this world than this Jewish carpenter rabbi from Nazareth. Millions and millions of people claim to follow him. But there's a lot of different views in our culture, and even I dare say in the church today, about who was Jesus? Was he a prophet who prophesied certain things? Was he simply a gifted rabbi who taught some incredible truths that, you know, if we all just followed some of the teachings of Jesus, the world would be a better place? Like, love your neighbor. That's pretty good, right? Do good to others. Like, if we just took some of the teachings of Jesus and just followed them, then the world would just be a better place. So is Jesus simply that? Was Jesus of Nazareth a threat to the Roman Empire, therefore they had to put him to death? Was he a threat to the established religious Jewish order of first century Palestine? Who was he, or was he more? So the reality is, Jesus, in his own words, told us exactly who he was. And when I was a youth pastor for over 10 years, one of the things that I would always tell teenagers is this: you have to do something with Jesus. Like, you can't just ignore him. He was real. He existed. He had an impact on this world. You can't just pretend that he didn't exist. You have to do something with Jesus. You have to do something with him. And if you just chalk him up as a rabbi who taught some really good truths that we should just live by, then you're not understanding that he was actually claiming himself to be much more than that. I mean, Jesus himself claimed to be way more than that. What did Jesus come to provide? So when he came to earth, he was born in that manger 2,000 years ago. Why? Now, if you grew up in this church in particular, I imagine your answer was, well, he was born to die, right? He was born to pay for the sin of the world, so that men and women by faith could come and have the curse of sin removed. That's what we've been preaching here at Faith for over 50 years. And that's true. However, many view Jesus a little differently. Well, what I found in this culture is a lot of times people will come to church and they'll try the Jesus thing out because they're hoping that there's something about this religious system that Jesus created that will ultimately just make my life better, because life is hard and life is difficult and life has trials and difficulties and circumstances that we don't necessarily, like life is hard, right? So what happens is people start searching and they start looking. They look for meaning, right? They look for purpose. They look for someone to take away the pain that is life. Broken relationships. Grief from losing loved ones. Disease that creates pain and suffering. Like people are looking, people realize, okay, something's broken in the world. So what can Jesus do maybe to make my life better? And I think one of the fundamental struggles that all of us have a tendency to drift into is to view Jesus as someone who came to make my life better. So if I come to Jesus, he'll make me happier, he'll make me healthier, he'll make me wealthier, and all I have to do is just trust in him. And actually, we're going to see from our text today that that's exactly what the crowd of the first century was wanting from Jesus. But that's not what Jesus said he would offer them. If you go to John chapter 6, we're going to see that Jesus, from our text today, is the only one who can satisfy and sustain our true hunger. Jesus is the only one who can satisfy and sustain true hunger. So there's going to be a difference between true hunger and what we would call false hunger. If you notice in the first 15 verses, there's a story that if you grew up in the church, you know really well. Jesus was preaching to the multitude, and it got long, and the day was wearing on, and they were getting hungry. And so what is Jesus do? He takes the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes and he feeds 5,000 people. He gives them bread to eat. He fills their stomachs. He supplies for their temporal material need for food. And that's verses 1 through 15. Jesus does this incredible miracle. He displays his power by feeding this multitude of people with such a small amount of food. And then if you come to me, with me to verse 22, it says, on the next day, so it's the next day after that, the crowd that remained on the other side of the sea, so Jesus had gone to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, and the crowd that had been fed by him was on the other side. So Jesus fed them and then left. That's verses 16 through 21. And on the next day, verse 22, the crowd that remained on the other side of the sea saw that there had been only one boat there and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Other boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum seeking Jesus. Well, this is really good, right? Like Jesus is being sought after by the crowds and the multitudes. Now, Jesus had left with his disciples. His disciples had gotten into a boat and left, and the weather got rocky, and so Jesus walks on water and gets in the boat and calms the sea, and then the crowds come, and they're like, we want Jesus. We want to find him. Where is he? So they get in their boats, and they head toward Capernaum, and they were seeking Jesus. That's a good thing, right? We want men and women to seek after Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when did you come here? I mean, basically, they're confused. Why did you leave? Things were going great. You were preaching. We were eating. This was a great relationship. Why'd you leave? Verse 26, notice what Jesus says. Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. So Jesus is questioning their motives for seeking him, isn't he? Why are you coming after me? Because of what you think I can give you in the way of temporal, material things, in this case, food. Now, we have a cultural issue here. How many of you are bread people? Like you're bread. I mean, you eat bread, all right? I married into a bread family, okay? So when you sit down at a restaurant and the bread comes, it's like, all right? All right, my middle son, he takes after that, he's a bread guy. They just love bread, okay? I mean, I'm okay with bread, I like bread, you know, but I'm not like, oh, bread, I love bread, you know? But some people are just bread people, okay? How many of us, our main food is bread? There might be a couple of you out there that's all I eat. All right. I mean, bread's what? Bread's something we eat before our meal, or we eat as a side part of, right? We don't live off of bread. It's not something. I mean, we might eat a lot of it, but it's not like the main thing we eat. If I were to ask you, what's your favorite snack? I mean, we could go through all kinds of things. Well, I like this, I like this. I grew up in Western Colorado, moving out to Eastern Pennsylvania. You guys have some, you know, with the kind of German, Dutch kind of culture, you have some interesting snacks, okay? I still don't get, but that's fine, that's cool. You eat some interesting things that I didn't grow up eating, but when I say, what's your favorite snack? If you were to go to the first century Galilean area and you were to ask someone what their favorite snack was, they would have no idea what you were talking about. You're talking about something like they didn't snack. They worked all day, most of them, for bread to eat. Like you worked mostly to eat. You didn't have extra food that you could snack on or this or that. In particular in this area, it was bread and fish. Bread was the staple for them. If you didn't have bread in this culture, you didn't have life. It was so important to survival for them that to not have it meant to not live. So we in our culture today, if we don't have bread, we're okay. I mean, we've got all kinds of things to eat. But in this culture, to take away bread was in a sense to take away life. And your very existence, your very labor, your job was mostly so that you could feed yourself and your family. And then you would get up and work the next day and you would make enough to feed your family. And so the bread for this culture was crucial for living. And Jesus gives them bread, right? How great is this? We come, we listen to you teach, we follow you, you give us bread, right? This is a good deal. And Jesus was questioning their motives. Why are you seeking me? You're only seeking me because I fed you, because I gave you bread. So what is the motive for seeking Christ? He questions their motive in this text. And then he says in verse 27, "Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you, for on him God the Father has set his seal." So what we see is that Jesus gives life because he is the true bread from heaven. Notice what he says. The response in verse 28 to him questioning their motives is this. They said to him, "What must we be doing to do the works of God?" So, listen, Jesus, this is a great relationship. Just tell us what we have to do. We will do it. You continue to provide this for us. In fact, we'll make you a king. You see, that's the reason Jesus departed from them, if you look in the preceding text. Fearing that they would make him a king, he departed from them. Why did they want him to be their king? Because he fed them. He gave them physical life through the bread that he gave them. So do you see what they were after? Jesus, this is a great setup. You just tell us what we should be doing, verse 28, the works of God. You tell us what we need to do. So come to church every Sunday. Okay, got that. All right. Tithe. Okay, I got that. Do this, live this way. Okay, I got that. Don't lie. Okay, I can do all of those things. And now, Jesus, if I do these things, then you need to give me what in return? Bread. Food. Translate it to our culture, church. Translate it to our culture. Okay, what do we need to do? What do I need to do over here so that God will do this over here? If I do all of these things, God, and this is a large part of, I think, the struggle of American evangelicalism. God, I will do all of these things. I will go to church. I will even tithe. I won't drink beer, and I won't go to rated R movies, and I won't do this, and I won't do that. Okay. I'll keep the list over here, God. I'll do these works over here. Now, in return, God, you need Jesus to provide this for me. You need to, take care of this, and you need to take care of this, and you need to take care of this. The problem with that is what happens is when we view Jesus the way this crowd was viewing Jesus, is a number of things happen. One primarily is when life does not go the way that you want it to go, what is the response? God, I did this for you. What are the works of God? I did this, and I did this. So I did all of these things for you, God, and look at what you didn't do for me. And I've seen a lot of people turn in anger toward God because they felt like they kept all of the works of God that they were supposed to get, and God didn't keep his end of the bargain. He let me get sick. He let me lose my job. He let my kids turn out, rebellious or whatever it is. And so we end up questioning the goodness of God because we feel like we kept our end of the bargain, but Jesus didn't. And this is exactly where this crowd was going. But the point that Jesus wanted to make is he gives life because he is the true bread. And so when they said, what must we do to be doing the works of God? Just tell us what to do, and we'll do what you want us to do, God, and you keep giving us bread. This was what they wanted from Jesus. They were missing who Jesus was. They wanted to make him some petty king who could just give them food as long as they did what he wanted them to do. And Jesus says, that's not who I am. Because in verse 29, he says to them, this is the work of God. That you do what? That you believe in him whom he has sent. This is the work of God. That you believe in him whom he has sent. And they said to him, then what sign do you do that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform? Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. And so they said, well, hold on a second. The work is what? Believe in Jesus. This is what you want us to do, believe. Well, what sign do you have to do? Because after all, our fathers, when they left Egypt and were wandering in the wilderness, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. So it worked out for them then, like they did what he wanted. God gave them bread to eat then. So we even have a verse to prove it, Jesus. So what sign are you going to do to show us that you are really who you say you are? And so the question at the end of the day was, who was Jesus. And the reality and what's being revealed here is they did not want to wrestle with who he was. They simply wanted him to give them what they wanted. And so, he says to them in verse 32, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the what? The true bread. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." And they said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." And Jesus said to them what? I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall not thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet do not believe. So if you bump up to verse 27, so understanding this conversation that takes place, they said, "Give us this bread." Jesus says, "I am the bread. I am the bread of life. If you come to me, you will not hunger. You have seen me, but you don't believe." And so if you bump back to verse 27, what does Jesus say? Do not what? Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. And so what Jesus is saying there is simply this: don't waste your life pursuing. And I'm going to throw out a concept here that I want you to understand, okay? Because it's kind of like, what is moralistic, therapeutic deism? It's exactly what this crowd of people were falling into, that Jesus simply exists to make me feel better. Jesus, help me feel better about myself. Help me feel better about my circumstances. Help me feel better. There's a thought out there. And this concept of moralistic therapeutic deism was coined by a university professor named Christian Smith, who did a study of teenagers in the early 2000s, and he followed them through their teenage years. Some of them claimed to be Christian, some of them were Mormon, but those that claimed to be Christian, at the end of the day, viewed church and Jesus through the lens of these three words. Moralistic. How can my life be better? Tell me what are the works of God that I can do so that Jesus can make my life better? But at the end of the day, the thought of deism is this: that while Jesus exists and while God exists, he's not particularly interested in my life, and he's not particularly involved in the things that are going on in my life. So yes, there's church, and yes, there's things that I need to be doing that are right and good and holy, and when things go bad, I can go to the church and I can go to Jesus, and it'll help me feel better about what's going on, and I can feel better after I leave a worship service, and I can feel better about who I am, and I can feel better, and then I've got to go back and do more works, and yet at the end of the day, when it comes to God, he's not really all that interested in what's going on in the individual aspects of my life. Therefore, God and religion and the church are separate from what's going on in my life personally. So what Jesus says is, don't labor for something that'll perish. Don't waste your life pursuing things that will not last. Do not come to Jesus bargaining with him, saying, "If I do these things, God, you must give me these things." Because what Jesus is saying is that he ultimately did not come to this earth to give you temporal possessions, What Jesus was asking this multitude or this congregation to do is wrestle with who Jesus is over what he can do to make your life easier. What this crowd wanted was, Jesus, make life easier. Tell us what we got to do. Give us bread. And what Jesus is saying, stop wrestling with what I can do to make your life easier and start wrestling with who I am, because that is the fundamental question that makes all of the difference in the world. If you get the question wrong of who Jesus is, it doesn't matter whether you have bread in this life or not. If you get that question wrong, it doesn't matter if you have health, wealth, or prosperity in this life. If you get the question of who Jesus is wrong, it will matter for all of eternity. And so what Jesus is saying is that he is the true bread from heaven, and that your true need. So he's looking at this multitude and he's trying to communicate to them and say, your true need is not the bread that I gave you when I fed you yesterday. Yes, that's a need that comes and goes. But I gave you bread, and what happened is you got hungry again. This bread that was given to your fathers in the wilderness was a symbolic picture of what I would give you so that you would never hunger again. And what he is talking about, when he talks about eating of the bread of life, he is equating that to belief and faith in Jesus for the forgiveness of sins. Because at the end of the day, Jesus satisfies a core hunger for something. See, we all have a core hunger, a spiritual hunger, a desire that says at the end of the day, I could have all of the health, wealth, and prosperity, all of the, use first century terms, all of the bread that I could ever want. But that isn't the true need of our lives, is it? And so what the point is so oftentimes we focus on the temporal needs of this world. And listen, we need food and we need shelter and we need clothing and we need all of those things. And I'm not saying Jesus isn't concerned about those things. He said he will supply those needs. But the point is if you live this life and you're content because, okay, I'm healthy, wealthy, and prosperous, or I have everything I need, but you get wrong who Jesus was, what happens is when you die? What happens when you die? That's the point. You need life beyond this life. That's the point. You need to satisfy a hunger that goes well beyond the hunger for food or for temporal possessions. You need something that will satisfy a core spiritual hunger that everyone's born with. We all realize that the world we're living in is broken, and if we're honest with ourselves, don't we all have to admit that we're all broken ourselves? So the question is who is going to satisfy this deep core hunger in my life? Who's going to satisfy it? Because man, maybe you've made a lot of money, or maybe you've got a great family, or maybe you're just really happy with the way life is going. Do you know at the end of the day that that's not your real need? That's not the real sense of being satisfied? Because at the end of the day, there is only one person who can satisfy the real true hunger. So when Jesus says, I am the true bread, what he's saying is, I will satisfy your true hunger. And so the true bread and the true hunger is actually a spiritual thing. It's actually, so the real bread that they ate in the wilderness, Jesus is saying, was a symbolic picture of the true bread who was Jesus Christ. And so eating and partaking of the bread of life is equal to faith and belief in Jesus himself. So when Jesus says, I am the true bread, what is he saying, or who is he saying that he is? He is saying that I am the only one who can satisfy your hunger. And I do that by obeying the will of my Father. And so, if you look in verse 35, he says to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall not thirst. So there's a hunger and a thirst that everybody has. It is a spiritual hunger and a spiritual thirst that everybody has. And if you approach Christianity or you approach the church, and this is the way a lot of people approach, if I try the Jesus thing out or if I try coming to church, then I expect Jesus to make my life better. You're missing the point. Because Jesus came to provide you with so much more. I get it. I get it. Your circumstances right now might be difficult. But Jesus came as a child born in that manger 2,000 years ago to provide you with so much more than simply changing your circumstances right now. That is the point that he's trying to convey to this crowd that's coming to him. Wrestle with who I am over what I can do to provide for your temporal needs. That's fundamental. So he says, if you'll come to me, if you'll come and partake of the bread of life, I'll satisfy your hunger. And I'll satisfy your thirst. You ever sat there and thought there's got to be more to life than working 9 to 5 every day, coming home, eating dinner, going to bed tired, getting up, and doing it all over again? Like how many of you that's a struggle sometimes. Like just like I'm in this cycle of life, and it just keeps and I wake up and now I'm 37 years old. And now I'm 50 years old, now I'm 60 years old, and there's got to be something more to this life than just getting up and working every day, right? There's got to be something more to this life than just going through the routine that I go through every day. And the point is, yes, there is. There's something way more. Yeah, you've got to go to work every day, and Jesus will provide for your daily needs. But that is not the sole reason for your existence. The reason you exist is for Christ, to know him, to experience him. This is why Jesus says, do not labor for food that will not last, in verse 27. Don't waste your life pursuing that. Invest your life in pursuing that which will last. That which does make a difference. And so he says, if you will come to me, if you are hungry, if you are thirsty, if there is a spiritual hunger and thirst in you, the only place where that can be satisfied is in a relationship with Jesus, period. It can't be found anywhere else. It can't be found in any other world religions. It can't be found in drugs or alcohol. And listen, I've seen this. What young people do, they get out of high school, they say, okay, there's got to be more than life than this. I want to experience all that there is to life, right? So what do? They start experimenting with all kinds of things, whether it's alcohol or drugs or sex. Why? Because they think that they can find something in that will satisfy them. We do it as adults, all right? We try and find satisfaction in our jobs, in our relationships. We try and find people and other things to fill us, and it just doesn't, does it? Like, have you ever really, really, really wanted something? And then got what you wanted, and it really wasn't what you thought it would be. You ever been there? Like we think when we reach this ceiling, okay, then I'm going to be happy. Then I'll have that hunger satisfied, and we hit it, and what happens? There's another one above it. Well, if I can just hit this, if I can make that promotion, if I can make that amount of money, if I can hit that, then I'll be happy. So Jesus, give me that, Jesus, give me that. And then we hit it, and what happens? It just doesn't. And so we burn ourselves out trying to pursue things that ultimately don't satisfy us, right? And yet Jesus comes along and says this. That hunger that's in you, that thirst for more, that core hunger, I'll satisfy it. I may not change your circumstances, but I'll change your life, and I'll satisfy your hunger, and I'll satisfy your thirst. And I'll do that by obeying my Father. Because notice what he says. Verse 36, but I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. You want me to give you bread, but you don't really believe who I am. The bread of life. You don't believe that. You're coming to me seeking me. You don't believe I'm the bread of life. You don't believe I can satisfy your hunger. All that the, verse 37, all that the Father gives me will come to me. All who the Father has given me, they will come to me. There are those that the Father has already, in eternity past, given to me to be mine, to be satisfied, to receive life, to receive this bread. There are those that the Father has already given to me, and those whom the Father has given to me, they will come to me. And that's most of you in here today, that in eternity past, God the Father had given you over to Christ to be filled, to receive life, to believe in Christ. Right? That's you and that's me if we're in Christ, if we're saved, our sins are forgiven. That's you and that's me. All that the Father gives me, they will. And so there was that time when you came. You responded to the gospel. You came to Christ broken and empty, and he saved you. So all that the Father has given me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. What the language of that verse is saying is all of those whom the Father has already given me, all of those who are already in the possession of Jesus, I will never, ever cast out. I won't do it. So this life from the bread of life that's given, is ours forever. Because he goes on and he says, verse 37, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven to do, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. So what is the passion of the heart of Christ? To save you? Or to do the Father's will? You cannot separate the two, can you? Because what is the Father's will? That I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. The Father's will is this: that you partake of the bread of life. And you find satisfaction in him. The passion of the heart of Christ, when he came to this earth 2,000 years ago as a baby born in that manger, his passion was to do the will of his Father. Every day he woke up, the thing that propelled him forward, the thing that propelled him from the cradle to the cross, was a unwavering passion for the will of the Father. Father, I will do your will. This was what made Jesus go. This is what propelled Jesus to do the things he did, and this is what caused Jesus to hang on a cross, the will of the Father. And what is the will of the Father? That he, Jesus, would lose none of you or me that were given over to Jesus, that he would lose none of them, but that he would receive all who would come to him, that he would receive them, that they would find satisfaction in him, not in the bread that he was giving, not in the changing of circumstances, not in the, okay, God, I'll do this, but that ultimately the will of the Father was this, the satisfaction of hunger and thirst for something greater, that real satisfaction would be found in God and God alone. That's the will of the Father for you. And that's what Jesus dedicated his ministry and his death to, that you would be filled, that you would be satisfied. Jesus was passionate about the will of the Father. The will of the Father was your satisfaction in him and him alone. Because Jesus knew that only God can satisfy us. And so I don't know what you're pursuing and chasing after right now that you think's going to make you happy or you think's going to change everything. I don't know. Listen, I get sucked into that so easily myself. Well, if only we could, okay, let me be honest with you. Can I be honest, okay? I know it's church and it's not the place for that, but I'm going to be honest, all right? You know? If faith at Sellersville could only be like this, if we could only grow to this amount, if we could only get, you know what I mean? So I start saying, if our church can do this, then I'll be considered a successful pastor, right? If the church can accomplish this, if we can do this, and they're all good things, right? But what's happening? As a pastor, I'm looking for satisfaction in what the church can accomplish and do to make me feel better about myself as a leader. You see the problem? The will of the Father would be that I would be satisfied with the bread of life. That my core hunger and thirst would be satisfied by Jesus. That I wouldn't waste my life pursuing things that will fade, but pursuing Christ, the bread of life, the true bread. And it goes on, for this is the will of my Father, verse 40. Here it is. That everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life. Listen, that at the end of the day, life may not go the way I want. This church may not go the way that I dream for this church to go. And let me tell you, I've got dreams for this church. I've got excitement for this church. But what if the next 30 years for me are marked by struggle or conflict or persecution or imprisonment? And it doesn't go the way that I want it to go. What do I have? I have the promise of eternal life. The satisfaction in God. Listen, church. Satisfaction in God comes through faith in Christ. Where is your faith? In Christ or in yourself or in people around you? Where is your faith? Because what this faith produces is this promise. It's the second time we see this promise in our text at the end of verse 40, and I will what? I will raise him up on the last day. This is what we look forward to. This is what we anticipate. This is what we desire more than anything, is that regardless of what happens in this life, and life is hard and life is disappointing and life has good times and it also has bad times, but at the end of the day, even for those of you who are getting toward the end of your life, what do you anticipate even more than those of us who are young? This promise here, that through my faith in Christ, my hunger is satisfied, and then from that flows this promise that on the last day I will rise again. that I will be raised up, that as Christ rose from the dead, so I will rise. And this is the glorious promise of the church, that one day we will rise when Jesus comes back. That's what we're anticipating and looking forward to. But in order to be a part of that final resurrection, we have to partake of the bread of life now. And that comes through a deep faith in Christ alone. And this is, church, the message that we're going to continue to proclaim over and over and over these next 4 weeks. And that's why I want to end with one more challenge to you. Who is it that you know that's searching desperately for life in every other part of this world except Jesus? Who is it that you know that needs to taste of the bread of life, to receive eternal life and have the hope of future glory? We have to make this a passion of our heart, church. We have to make this a desire that we have, that we would not just come here and be fed ourselves, that we would not just come and do the works of God, but that we would take seriously the mission of God, that there is a world out there who hungers, like they are hungry. Do you see it? Do you see that they're desperately looking for something to fill this hunger that's in them? And we have the bread of life. We have the bread. It's right here. There's hungry people walking all around. We have the bread, but what do? We hoard it. We hang on to it. We have the bread. We've tasted of it. We've received it. We know it. We've experienced it, and it's glorious. Let's give it out. Let's give the bread. Because what Jesus came to do was this: the will of his Father. And the will of the Father, I'll read it one last time, is that everyone who looks on the Son believes and receives eternal life. Father, so many times, God, in my life, I'm looking for satisfaction in so many other places than Jesus. So my prayer for faith at Sellersville this morning is that we would be a church that finds satisfaction in Christ and Christ alone. God, that we would not look to you for what you can give us in this temporal, material, worldly possessions, but that, God, we would look to you for what you can offer us in our spiritual need that is greater than any physical need. God, I thank you that you're glorious. I thank you that Jesus is beautiful. I thank you that he is the true bread of life, that he gives life, that sustains us and that satisfies us, God. I thank you that we've experienced that in this house this morning. I thank you that we've known it and that we've received it. But God, that's not enough, because you've commanded us to share and to give and to proclaim the bread of life. And so I pray, Father, as we head into the next few weeks, and even months, but Lord, particularly through this Christmas season, as we have opportunities around the Christmas holiday to talk about Jesus, to talk about this baby that was born and who he was, I pray that you would give us opportunities, God, to talk about Jesus, to talk about who he really was, Lord, with coworkers and with family members and with friends and with relatives, God, that you would give us opportunities to have those conversations, that you would give us boldness, God. And I pray that from that, Lord, we'd be able to invite others out to be in church, to hear the sermons that are preached that talk about the glory of Christ. God, I pray that you would save people. I pray that you would call people out of darkness into life. God, I pray that this Christmas season, you would satisfy people's hunger by them receiving the true bread from heaven. God, we're asking for you to work miracles in people's lives. God, I pray that you would give us a passion for this, a heartbeat for this, and that you, God, would display your glory among us by calling men and women to receive the bread of life. So Lord, satisfy us with your goodness. Satisfy us with your grace. God, I know there's a lot of struggles out here in this crowd this morning. Lord, I pray that you'd satisfy our true hunger for you. We ask this in your name and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.